Hey, hello, everybody. I'd like to thank everybody in attendance, especially the fans who've packed the Jocko Refuel Lounge here at the 2023 CrossFit Games. We're not going to waste any time here, but I would like to introduce CEO Don Fall and GM Dave Castro. And I know, Don, you just want to get things going by saying a couple words.
Yeah, thank you, Chris. Thanks to everybody for being here. Welcome to Madison. Welcome to the 2023 NOBULL CrossFit Games. We're incredibly excited. Our team's been working really, really hard over the last few months with a bunch of our partners to make sure that we create an incredible experience for you guys this week. So we hope you love every minute of it. Also wanted to say thanks for folks in the press. You guys play a really important role for the millions of fans around the world who couldn't be here in Madison to experience this. You guys help connect them to what's happening here. So really appreciate the role that you guys play. Appreciate you guys being here. So, Dave and I are going to get into questions, but wanted to just share a few things before we do that. For me, yesterday was my 1 year anniversary in the job. So, most folks probably lost the over under on how long I would make it, but still here. Over the course of the last year, really proud of the work that our team has done. So we got back from the games last year and got to work. Supporting our affiliates, investing in our partnership there, investing in and really working, going deeper with our coaches who we know play a fundamental role in delivering this amazing experience for members of our community, working hard to build strong partnerships, folks who believe in what we're doing and can help accelerate and amplify it, and working hard to make sure that we came into this year to deliver an even better experience through sport, and a whole host of things that are trending in an awesome direction. The state of the community is really strong. If we look at where we are from an affiliate perspective, we are seeing now really strong growth in a bunch of important markets around the world. Emerging markets like Western Europe, Korea on fire, but also we're seeing growth in the US in some of our oldest markets, which is something we haven't seen for a little while. We're also seeing incredible retention and engagement from our affiliates. Our retention there hasn't been this strong in over a decade. And as we get out there and get a chance to talk with our affiliate owners, we're hearing awesome things about what they're seeing and feeling from their community. We got a lot of work left to do, but we're really encouraged by the progress. As I mentioned, lots of progress and work across the board, investing and deepening our partnership with affiliates, going deeper with our coaches to elevate the experience we can deliver on the floor, continuing to invest in great partnerships and making sure that sport is an incredible experience. And all of those things, all the things that we've been working on fundamentally are united in driving towards, what we view as our most important role, the most important objective, which is reaching more people and changing more lives through CrossFit. As magical as what we'll see this week is, at the end of the day, what is so transformative about this amazing thing that we are a part of is the impact that it can have on people's lives. And our primary goal is figuring out, for those folks who have not discovered this yet, how do we expose them to it? How do we get them off the couch and into that local affiliate where that life-changing journey can start? And in that vein, as we think about reaching more people, we've got some really exciting news to share with you guys for the first time. Starting tomorrow, CrossFit Games is back on ESPN. So we literally finalized and signed this contract about an hour ago. I might have been a little anxious about whether or not it would close before this. I just want to say a huge thanks. We've had folks on our team hustling and working really hard for the last couple months when this opportunity presented itself to make it happen, because we think this is one of the most powerful things that we can do to elevate this community, elevate this sport, reach more people. Over the course of the last years, I've gotten a chance to meet thousands of people from our community. I always ask folks, hey, where did it start for you? Where did your journey with CrossFit start? And for a lot of people, they talked about turning on ESPN back in the day and seeing the games and being wowed and inspired by what they saw there and motivated to go check it out. And so we're really fired up at a step that we believe elevates our sport and our community on the very highest stage to allow us to reach more people. So we're really excited to share that with you guys. Now, at the same time, I also wanted to talk a little bit about some other decisions that we had to make. I'd say look, over the course of the last year, for me, I'd been a fan of the games. I've watched the games sitting at home. Over the course of the last year, I got to better understand what it takes to pull this off. For those of you guys that haven't gotten a chance to see it, there are probably 1,000 people, many of which, most of which are volunteers, who work extraordinarily hard to pull off this amazing event and experience. There are a ton of investments and resources that need to go into delivering a great experience. What that means for us, unfortunately, sometimes is we got to make tough calls. We'd love to be able to do everything pragmatically. That's not possible. So there are times when we got to take a step back and say, okay, what are the things, what are the choices we make that we believe best further this goal, best serve and support the community? One of those decisions was a decision we made this week about live streaming adaptive in Masters. And look, that experience was a really challenging one. Not a great experience. We knew that coming in. That was a really, really hard decision and trade-off. And understand if you're a family member at home, if you're an affiliate owner who's got an athlete competing, if you're a coach that has helped an athlete prepare, how frustrating that experience must have been for you at home, tuning into that. What made that decision especially hard and challenging for us is that for a lot of people, and as incredible as our elite athletes are, for a lot of folks, the most inspiring stories are the adaptive athletes, the Masters athletes. Yeah, for me, my most memorable moment last year was Thursday night, the adaptive award ceremony. Like I won't forget that. And so for us, that made that decision all that much more difficult. Now, what we want to do is make sure that we do what we can to elevate those stories, to inspire other people. And so what our team has been working on is making sure we capture as much as we can over the last couple of days so that we can package and elevate those stories to get them on ESPN, to get them in front of people so people can see and be inspired by those amazing athletes. So our team's been working really hard on that, and we hope to show that over the course of Friday, Saturday, Sunday, tomorrow, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, as those athletes go live on ESPN. We also made a couple other big investments this year to try to connect fans outside the US. And so for the ESPN broadcast, we've also made the decision this year to live stream with localized commentary for 4 international markets and language outside of English. Now, 4 is a start. We know we've got more work to do, but that's an investment that we're making this year that we think is in service of connecting more of our international community with the experience here in Madison. And so lastly, I'm gonna hand off to Dave. Our team, as we speak, is updating the streaming schedule on games.crossfit.com, on our social channels. Go check it out. Thank you for being patient as we hustled up until the 11th hour to get that done. And we've got to make sure that, you know, whether you're watching on ESPN or many of our streaming options, that all of our fans are going to be able to enjoy the action everywhere around the world. Finally, before I hand off to Dave, I wanted to take a moment to say a thank you to the city of Madison. So as you guys may have heard, this will be our last year in Madison. We've been here 6 years. It has been an incredible run. This city, the community, could not have been more welcoming. From small business owners downtown to the folks in the city who worked so hard to make sure that we felt welcome, to this beautiful landscape that we get to use to put on an incredible experience. We could not be more grateful. The city of Madison has set a high bar for where we want to go next. Our goal is to bring this experience to as much of our community around the country and around the world over time. And so bittersweet, we're super grateful and really appreciate everything from the city of Madison for what they've done to be incredibly welcoming hosts for us. Thank you.
I'm gonna take a little different approach to this, as you can imagine. Does anyone have any questions?
Yes. We'll open it up. If I can just ask a favor, when you do ask a question, there's microphones in the back. They'll come from the back. Just please state your name and the outlet and who your question is addressed to.
Hi, Ricardo Scioli from Brazil, from Hugo Cross. My question is on the ESPN deal. Is that something that is going to go abroad, like for ESPN Brazil and other locations in the world?
So this year it is not. So we will have options for our folks in international markets to engage. We hope this is the start of an amazing partnership with ESPN.
Anyone else have a question? Up in the front.
Will Romano, Wisconsin State Journal. Do you have any reasoning behind leaving Madison, moving the competition elsewhere? And do you have any information you can share on where it's going to be moving in future years?
It's a really tough decision to leave the city. We've had a blast here. When I was flying in, I remember the first trip I came out here to, we were on a 3-city tour looking at a number of venues who had requested to host us. And it was the final three. And Chattanooga, Tennessee was one of them. We spent a few days there. Then we came here. And the first night we came in, let me even back up further. It was right after the games. It was right after the games in Carson. And like a week or two later, Justin was like, hey, dude, we need to go start touring cities. And I'm like, the last thing I want to do right now is tour any cities. And so we got on planes anyways, and we started touring the different locations. So I was kind of already in a grumpy headspace, let's call it. But went out there, came here, went to Chattanooga. It wasn't going to work out. The format, the venue wasn't ideal for what we needed. The city was great, but it wasn't, they didn't have the amenities or what we needed. We came here, and some of the best memories I have of this place is the first tour that we took. And we walked around. First, they took us on a boat tour, and that was cool, but I wasn't into it. That kind of the lakes and all that at that point didn't matter in venue selection. So then I was like, hey, when are we going to see the actual venues? Then they brought us here. And when we first started walking around, it definitely was not clicking at first. We looked at the expo hall, which was really nice. We came to the stadium, which was good, but it just felt like the pieces weren't falling together. We walked around, looked at everything, and then started kind of seeing where things could go. Well, we could put a venue outside, kind of like the soccer field that we had in Carson, and we can do this in here, and we could put the athletes there, and we could have vendors here. And when it clicked, I mean, it clicked. Like, we knew we were coming here, and got super excited, made the decision, and then obviously been back for a number of years. We've done a lot of great things here, but there's a few things that that have gone into the decision to make this happen. One, I really do think in the future for the sport, it does need to move around, and it does need to hit other locations and other cities. And the intent here too was actually to leave a few years ago, but for whatever reasons, we decided to extend for a couple additional years. And as great as it's been, having a new look, a new venue, a new city is the right move for the future of the sport. For where we want to take this, for what we want to do, staying in one location is not the right strategy. With that comes also rethinking how we do all of this. And definitely, I've been thinking a lot, and the team has been thinking a lot about how we execute on these. And this is a massive layout. This is a massive venue. This is a massive event. So to actually put it in a place to where we can someday maybe end up in Brazil, someday end up in Europe, replicating a format or a venue or a games event like this, is not incredibly scalable, especially when you talk about overseas venues. So we are rethinking and relooking at different ways to do this going forward to give us that flexibility. But I mean it, like, some of our best memories were made here. We love this place. We'd love to do stuff here in the future, but right now it's time to move on.
We'll go to Scott.
Scott Schweitzer, Clydesdale Media. This is about the affiliates. There's a lot of positive feedback and momentum coming out of the affiliate gathering in Portland. What steps are you taking to get that message out to the entire world?
Yeah, great question. Thank you. And I think we had an incredible time in Portland. So for folks that don't have the context, we arrange affiliate gatherings in each of our regions here in the U.S. twice a year. We also do it internationally. So when we travel, our biggest priority is spending time with the community. This is one way that we get a chance to connect with our owners, connect other owners to each other, learn what we could be doing better, and talk about and communicate where we're going. We've got a partnership with affiliates. We work together. Our job is to make sure they're incredibly well supported so that they can do the work they need to do to impact lives. And we came back from our event in Portland where we talked a little bit about what we've been up to. Hey, what are the things that we've been doing in service of supporting you? What are the things we've learned? What progress we've made? What hasn't worked? And what should you expect from us in the next 6 months? And our intent with that is to make sure that our owners understand we are working on their behalf. And a little bit of it is asking also, it's a partnership. We need their help. We need them to step up as well. And what we realized coming back from it is there were too many owners who had to be there in person to hear that from us. And as amazing as that event was, there were a lot of owners for a variety of reasons who couldn't be there. And so we came back and said, we need to make sure that that conversation isn't just happening in person at these events, that we're getting that in front of every single one of our owners around the world. So we got some news coming on this shortly. We are going to update how we communicate in service of addressing this specifically, where owners are hearing from us probably on a quarterly basis. So every 3 months, there's going to be a similar update. What have we been working on? What's coming? Why are we doing it? What worked? What didn't work? And what they should expect from us moving forward. Thanks, Scott.
Savon did a pretty good job of covering it.
Do we have any more questions? We'll go up, Yash, and then we'll go to Mike.
Hey, Don and Dave. My name is Yash, Coaching Your Coaching podcast. My question is, as CrossFit gets bigger and bigger, athletes are getting into the sport at younger and younger ages with hopes of getting into the CrossFit games. What would be your pitch to them to hitch their careers onto the future of CrossFit?
Patience and respect the process. I think a lot of people, and this isn't even for just young athletes, it's for all athletes, all CrossFitters, definitely don't try to rush it. Don't try to take shortcuts. Don't try to expect too much too quickly, and respect the time it takes to get to certain places without getting too aggressive and wanting too much too fast. That's the biggest advice I have for any of the young athletes. Some of them have been doing it for a very long time and expect to be maybe further in their journey and then start looking at their programming or looking at this or looking at that. And even just going back to the basics, mechanics, consistency and intensity, and focusing on that is a necessary part of the path to be at this highest level.
We'll go to Mike in the front row. Far side, yellow shirt.
Thank you. Mike Halpin, Be Friendly Fitness. I guess my question is for both of you, but start with Don. Don, you worked at Athos before this. It was using a lot of data and to drive performance. Could we see something like that that's been used in other types of similar gyms and things of using data to drive what's going on in affiliates and how, and I even noticed in like sort of the benchmark sort of push here towards the games is using more data towards that. And then also using that in the games to sort of show out athletes' performance further than just saying who won and who did the best in that event.
So I'll start and then I'll hand it over to Dave. I think in the long run for us, data is, I think, a really big opportunity for us. Like at the end of the day, data is something we think about in service of better supporting our customers. How do we use it to better support our members? How do we better support our coaches? How do we support our owners? I think one of the first steps that we can take is as we think about, we've got an opportunity through some of this to equip our coaches and owners to better understand their members in service of delivering a better experience. So I can imagine down the line, and this is not immediate, not short-term, but helping a coach understand for individual members what the recovery looks like. And if a coach understands that by virtue of some of this data, do they have the opportunity to expand the scope of how they coach and support their athletes as well? I think also for our members, we know fundamentally, look, one of the things that we really deeply believe in is that measuring your results, putting your results on the board are important in terms of motivation, accountability, transparency. And so as we take steps towards things like making it easier for folks to update their profile through benchmarks. It's really in service of that same goal, making it easier for members to understand the progress that they're making to drive increased level of accountability and motivation.
So the stopwatch, that's the most important data we need in this community. And we've been data driven from the very beginning. So all of our results are based off of this right here. And there's a lot of supplemental stuff. There's a lot of stuff that you can use that gives you additional information. But at the end of the day, increasing work capacity across broad time and modal domains via tracking with just this and everything here, we're basically measuring someone's power output via this competition, via these competitions. So where we sometimes get a bad rap for not being data driven, we are absolutely data driven, especially by just tracking and keeping score.
We have time for just a couple more, and then we'll go back to Scott.
So to the stream of the age groups, was that a business decision or because of the lack of the deal with ESPN at that moment?
I'm not sure. So look, for everything, a lot of the decisions we make at the end of the day come back to the overarching goal. And you could call that a business decision. At the end of the day, we have resources. Our job is to make decisions and investments that align with our philosophy, our principles in service of helping people. This decision, yes, we looked at it. What is, at a high level, how do we think about resource allocation that best serves our community? What would it take to do it? How does that trade off against other things that we can use to deliver an amazing experience for our fans who are here and our fans around the world who can't be here in person? The timing of that, was a related but not directly tied to ESPN per se.
We will be streaming the final too. So the final event, we will have the final age group events tomorrow will be standard, not streamed on ESPN, but on our channels.
All right, Yash, just hang on one second. There's no questions online, correct? Okay, Yash, we'll end with your question.
Hey Don, congrats again on the year. Looking back at your first year, what were some of the biggest milestones?
The things I think I'm most proud of, you know, what I'd start with, I think, is what I touched on a little bit earlier. I think the sense of, and a couple other folks who I've talked to today have mentioned it, I think there's a feeling of optimism and positivity and growth. I've talked to a number of vendors who are here this week who are saying the activity, the engagement here is well above where we were last year. I think that is indicative of what we are seeing across the entirety of the community from our owners. Again, we got a lot of work to do, but I think we are moving in a direction towards exposing more people to CrossFit, towards building stronger affiliates, towards elevating the work we do to make sure our coaches are the undisputed, most respected leaders in the space. Incredibly proud of that because it required a partnership with the community. And because our team has been working really, really hard. And I'd say the second thing, look, at the end of the day, everything that we aspire to do is based on the team that we at HQ put on the field and the partnerships we build with other folks in the community who are working in service of growing it. And I think I'm incredibly proud of our team. We've come a really long way. Folks work. We have a tiny, tiny team for a community of our size. Our community has tens of thousands of small businesses, millions of members in over 150 countries with three kind of separate businesses. We have a tiny, tiny team, and they work so, so hard. We don't always get it right, but everyone always wants to get it right. And I'm really, really proud of how far our team has gone. That not only reflects what we've accomplished, but it sets us up to make sure next year's going to be better. Like next year, we will achieve more, and we're on that path, and I feel great about that.
Thanks, Don. Most importantly, I'd like to thank all the fans who showed up. We're still about 5K for a lot of incredible athletes that they have to get through tonight. So I'd encourage you to go out to the 5K course and cheer those athletes on. Don, Dave, thanks for your time. Let's look forward to these broadcasts on ESPN. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it. Yeah.